Simon & Schuster Audio presents Star Trek Into Darkness, a novelization by Alan Dean Foster. Based on the motion picture screenplay by Roberto Orsi, Alex Kurtzman, and Damon Lindelof. Based upon Star Trek, created by Gene Roddenberry. Read by Alice Eve.
Chapter 1. Class M Planet Nibiru. It seemed as if not just the supervolcano, but every square meter of solid ground on the planet was on the verge of shaking itself apart. The serpentine smoke cloud that emerged from the enormous towering cone stretched far out to sea, retaining its ominous coherence even as it cast much of the ocean's surface in shadow. Struggling to escape the noxious gases that rose from the planet's interior, troubled flying creatures sought clearer air to the north and south. Meanwhile, landslides periodically thundered down the volcano's slopes as its insides continued to swell, while the magma-clogged throat coughed and rumbled threateningly. Far below the outer planetary crust, something was building, something that portended far more than a mere series of Strombolian eruptions. Designed by its builders to withstand intermittent quakes and recurring tectonic stutters, constructed of hand-hewn stone, the massive temple situated not far from the mountain's base violently trembled, but did not fall. Mute and immovable at the convergence of multiple pathways that had been laboriously cleared from the red-leaved forest, it had stood thus for many hundreds of cycles. The bipedal figure that burst from the bas-relief framed entrance was moving as fast as possible. While the simmering volcano appeared the greater threat, the more immediate one took the form of dozens of figures who emerged from the interior of the temple in hot pursuit. The bright yellow cowls and loincloths they wore stood out in sharp contrast to their skin, which more than anything resembled the cracked and splitting clay that might be found at the bottom of a long, dried-out lake bed. Primitive, simple symbols and lines of painted vegetable dye marked their otherwise bare bodies. Their yelling and screaming formed a nightmarish cacophony that contrasted with the lead figure's heavy breathing. The grey cloth wrappings James Tiberius Kirk wore had disguised him. Now they interfered far too much with his breathing as he struggled to stay ahead of his pursuers. Whipping them off, he sucked in one desperate lungful of alien air after another as he dodged primitive spears that would terminate his life as surely as any phaser. Around him, the deep red Nibiran forest seemed intent on deliberately impeding his flight. Emitting a howl of outrage in memory of the desecration that had just taken place in their most holy temple, the High Nibiran priest shook the weapon he was carrying as he urged on his fellows. Though the Nibirans were decidedly humanoid, their rounded facial features, ritually marked clay-coloured skin, and black, pupil-less eyes marked them as genetically and evolutionarily different from the humans they otherwise closely resembled. As the object of their fury, Kirk fought to lengthen his stride as he ran. He knew that if he was caught in possession of the scroll he had snatched from the temple, his pursuers would show him no mercy. He would be dead before he could explain that his intentions were wholly benign. He had to just keep running. If all went according to plan, that would not be much longer. It couldn't be much longer, he knew. His legs were turning to rubber while his lungs threatened imminent surrender. The branches and tendrils of the surrounding forest whipped at him. Every second they slowed him, allowing the furious Nibirans to draw that much closer. A foraging mother and child gazed up at him with wide eyes as he bolted past. Sitting on a red branch, a creature that resembled a yellow anemone drew tentacles back into its sack-like body as he sped by. He didn't know if it was plant, animal, or a combination of both, and at the moment, he didn't care. Down a slope blanketed in red foliage, across a stream and into a small clearing he raced, where, startled by his sudden emergence from the thick undergrowth, a massive, fanged quadruped reared directly and unexpectedly in front of him. The phaser Kirk drew was as technologically out of keeping with his surroundings as a ram hydrofoil would have been in a traditional sailing regatta. Before huge paws could come down on him, he hit the animal with a full blast from his weapon. It promptly collapsed in a pile of legs, fur, and dismay, revealing another masked biped behind it. Facing Kirk, but weaponless, this second figure fumbled to remove its own facial wrappings. The face, soon revealed, was contorted, but no more so than usual. "Damn it, man," Leonard McCoy sputtered. "That was our ride. You just stunned our ride." Confronting the ship's doctor and still breathing hard, Kirk barely managed to mutter a frustrated, "Great," before the babble of the pursuing mob of enraged Nibirans rose above every sound except the dangerously deepening growl of the looming volcano. Gesturing in lieu of speech, Kirk beckoned for McCoy to join him as he resumed his flight. With a last regretful glance at the immobile local riding beast, the doctor followed. Taking note of the rolled tube of local parchment that Kirk clutched like a relay runner's baton, McCoy nodded in its direction. "What the hell is that?" "I don't know." The captain was fighting for breath now, each lungful demanding an increasingly painful effort. He motioned in the direction of the bellowing native throng behind them. "But they were bowing to it!" As a second glance showed the lead Nibirans continuing to close the space between them, he drew his communicator with his free hand and snapped the instrument open. "Kirk to Shuttle One. Locals are out of the immediate kill zone. I've given them something else to focus on. You're clear to proceed as we discussed. I repeat, you are clear to proceed. Operations a go now." Lowering the communicator, he looked to his left. "You know, for someone whose expertise resides in what is essentially a sedentary profession, you move pretty good." A spear slammed into the tree just to his right. Behind them, the immense volcano was beginning to spill streams of lava down its flanks, bleeding bright red-orange against the dark basaltic slopes. McCoy's gasping reply was as dry as the chief engineer's favorite gin. "Being chased by howling homicidal indigenes has a way of enhancing my sprinting ability." His tone darkened. "Of course, if you hadn't shot our ride." Kirk shook his head. "Can't hear you, Bones. Volcano noise. Volcano noise, my—" Computer-augmented stability controls notwithstanding, Hikaru Sulu had to fight to hold the shuttle steady. As the interior of a fast-rising volcanic plume and its accompanying blasts of acidic gases was not the most salubrious location for a hovering shuttlecraft, it required Sulu's full attention to keep the compact craft from being knocked arse over tea kettle. Or worse, cast on an out-of-control vector toward the unforgiving ground below. There was nothing wrong with audio reception, however. Kirk's voice filled the cockpit. "Copy that, Captain." A glance rearward showed that while well underway, preparations for the final aspect of their questionable intervention were not yet complete. Shorn of anything resembling spare time, Sulu made his concern known in no uncertain terms. "We have to do this now, people. If we sit in this murk much longer, the acids in the off-gassing are going to start impacting our systems. All we have to do is lose one thruster and we risk going down." His warning was acknowledged with a hand wave. It was not half-hearted, but half-human. Turning back to Nyota Uhura, Spock stood stoically as she continued sealing him into the exosuit. Designed for heavy-duty work under the most extreme conditions, the brilliantly metallic, copper-coloured suit was far less flexible than its standard-issue cousins. It could protect its wearer from nearly anything, but it could not make Spock comfortable. The latter did not concern the Vulcan. Survival did. Tilting his head slightly to one side, he spoke towards the suit's pickup. Captain, did any representatives of the indigenous intelligence see you? At the risk of repeating the obvious, and despite the difficulties inherent in our current effort, I must repeat that the Prime Directive clearly states that there can be no perceived external interference with the internal development of an alien civil... Despite the shuttle's increasingly violent rocking, Kirk's response came through clearly. No, Mr. Spock, they did not. I know what it says. I might have missed a few details here and there in certain classes. The admirable clarity of the...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.